Namaskar. On behalf of PIB, I welcome you all to this press conference on Union Budget 2021-22. I offer my sincere congratulations to the Minister of Finance and Corporate Affairs, Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman ji, for presenting the budget in Parliament today. Ma'am, we are privileged and honored to have you with us. I extend a warm welcome to you, ma'am. I extend warm welcome to Minister of State for Finance and Corporate Affairs, Sri Anurag Singh Thakur ji. I welcome Finance Secretary, Dr. Ajay Bhushan Pandey, Secretary Expenditure, Sri T.B. Somanathan, Secretary Financial Services, Sri Devasis Pandey, Secretary Economic Affairs, Sri Tarun Bajaj, Secretary Deepam, Sri Tuhin Kant Pandey, Chief Economic Advisor, Dr. K.B. Subramanian. First, the Finance Minister will make her opening remarks, then we will take some questions from you friends. Ma'am, over to you, please.
Thank you, and good afternoon. This budget, of course, comes at a time when all of us desire to give greater impetus to the economy. And that impetus, we thought, would be qualitatively spent and give the necessary demand push if we choose to spend big on infrastructure. That is why if there are two important features of this budget, it is that we chose to spend big on infrastructure, which spans across roads, bridges, ports, power generation, and so on. And also to, as a second feature, attend to the need of the health sector. And even there, capacities for better health management had to be brought in the light of what we have gone through in the last year. And therefore, capacity building in health has taken a very big place in the budget. I've just given a probably just a feeler on what capacities we are talking about, whether it is establishing of labs, whether it is establishing of National Institute of Virology, or whether it is looking at the blocks where you need critical care centers, or whether you're looking at testing labs. Let's just remind ourselves that when the lockdown happened, we had probably just a few, two, if I'm right, two or three testing labs in this country. During the lockdown, that number was increased to a couple of hundred. Now, therefore, one of the things that we've aimed here is testing labs, Institute of Virology, aspirational districts having better health care. So infrastructure spend for health has gone down to the level of planning for the block level requirements, aspirational district level requirements, state level requirements, and national institute level requirements. So two feature when I said are one in general spending on infrastructure, for which there is a 37% increase in the budget. 5,45,000 crores is what we are giving for this year. And health, it was also something which received something like 94,000 crores in B of this year, has gone to 223,00,000 crores. So you find big numbers in health, big numbers in infrastructure. But this doesn't really mean that we've ignored agriculture, where there too we have placed emphasis. I've increased, as I read it out in the budget, the allocation for NABARD for, you know, being able to send more credit through to the farmers. Agricultural infrastructure development, CESS, is something which we are bringing in without on any one single item wherein we are putting the CESS, the end consumer paying more than what he's paying today. It is just a restructuring we've done, for instance, of the basic customs duty, where it was, let us say, 12%, we brought it down to 7% and added possibly only 3% on the infrastructure development CESS. End of the day, the consumer has ended up paying that much only or less. In no category has he ended up paying more after the agricultural infrastructure development CESS. That we have done only because we wanted to be sure that in order to improve agricultural infrastructure, we have a dedicated amount coming out of the budget. Rather than that going into the consolidated fund, it might still go, but we know what has got to be used for agricultural infrastructure. So if these are the kinds of things broadly we've done, equally important is the reform that we're bringing in the financial sectors. Disinvestment to continue, LIC to have IPO, insurance sector to have more in terms of opening up for 74% for FDI. These are very clearly steps, progressive steps in financial sector. Other than that, one major cry of all the banks have been the NPAs, for which we have been repeatedly giving capital infusion. In order that the bank books are cleared and cleaned up, we have come with an announcement of a formulation through which the NPAs will be culled out of the bank's books based on some formulation, not any discretion there. It goes to a holding company-like structure, which after doing the necessary, you know, sprucing up and also cleaning up and weeding out problems of that particular asset, will be through an open process, attract asset reconstruction companies which can come and bid for those assets. Even at that stage, after some haircut obviously, banks will get some money back to those NPAs for which they only kept provisioning for the NPA but didn't have the wherewithal to dispose them off legitimately. So we are giving that comfort to the banks. And also for funding the infrastructural requirements, a development finance institution is being brought in. All lessons learned from the IDBI, which started as a DFI but later went on to become a scheduled commercial bank-like functioning and couldn't succeed at that, are taken on board. So this DFI, even as it comes with about a 20,000 crore given by the government, which with a little more every now and then added, will eventually be used for raising about 5 lakh crores in a matter of next 3, 4, 5 years, is a formulation where when the law gets passed on that, we will still have an opportunity for the private sector also to set up their own development finance institution. So this country is not going to be, the needs of this country are such that just one development financial institution which is set up by the government will be adequately meeting up with the demand requirements? No. And therefore, we see a future for a DFI, which is partly funded by the government and raises capital from the market, is also competing with private sector DFIs. Largely this much, but very quickly I'll move over to talking about how we have not lost the opportunity to clean up government's own books. I had started it in July 2019-20, continued it in February 20, and even now we have made accounts more transparent. Nothing is pushed under the carpet. You're showing clearly where's the money going. Money given to FCI is also brought on board. So accounting of government expenditure and revenue statements are all now lots more transparent and open. And absolutely, upfront stated the fiscal deficit, where everybody was advising, and rightly because everyone had concern that the economy should revive, advising us, please spend more. We not only ensured that capital expenditure of the government was repeatedly reviewed and spending was encouraged and pushed, we ensured that the spending will not get delayed, and that is why even though we announced one capital expenditure amount during the BE, even that has gone up, that in the RE I had to make additional provisions for it. With that in mind, we have also increased the spending in the forthcoming year. As a result, borrowing increased. Our fiscal deficit, which started at 3.5 during February 2020, has gone to 9.5% of the GDP. So we have spent, and we have spent. Otherwise, your fiscal deficit wouldn't have reached this number. But does that mean that we are going to show it and forget it? We've also given a clear glide path for deficit management and bringing it down. The Finance Commission has also been suggesting that we should be giving a glide path. We've given our glide path, I think, which broadly explains where we are, broadly gives you a broad picture. Specific items are also there, about which we can expand, but I suppose in response to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Six.
Ma'am, you rightly said that the glide path has been mentioned, and you did lay it out that over the next 5 years, we might see the fiscal deficit coming down. But how hopeful are you with the current expenditure roadmap that you have given, that the fiscal deficit for the next year will be contained in that particular figure of 6.8%? Because the borrowing number also again continues to be quite high. And what gives you confidence in terms of job creation? That is what people have been wanting to hear from you, because a lot of people in the pandemic lost their jobs and they are yet to get back their jobs.
Haven't we announced an incentive scheme for people to join back and people to take their jobs back, for employers to take employees who were thrown out, to bring them back and have some money paid from the government for their EPFO and so on? So we have worked out a scheme. And that scheme will run for the course of the, I think, till about next year, June. We've allowed people to get all those people who they threw out of their jobs to be back in the job, for whom we will pay the EPO for 2 years. So we have given an incentive for people to take them back.
That's the next question. I think let the next question be moved to the next person, 31.
One minute.
You asked a question on the deficit, whether we'll be able to contain ourselves in 6.8% or not. If you notice our revenue figures for this time, the revenue figures, if anything, are understated and not overstated. Because otherwise, by this time, all of you would have been coming out and telling us that we won't be able to achieve. So we have taken our nominal GDP 14.4% and the revenues at 16.7. So the buoyancy is only 1.16. We are hopeful that we will be able to get more than this and also achieve more in the other areas of non-tax revenue and the disinvestment. And we will definitely be within 6.8 and could be lower also.
Just to add on the job creation, the significant increase in outlay for infrastructure that ma'am has done will also have a sharp impact on job creation, especially in the informal sector, because construction activity actually creates both positive and negative spillovers, basic positive linkages, and thereby job creation in the informal sector.
Ma'am, se pehle har ye ka ke sabse zyada se zyada demand paida ki hum logon se jo saving the karne ke mein aise ये डिमांड पैदा कर सकती है आपके हिसाब से, क्योंकि जो इंफ्रा पे खर्च करने की बात है या दूसरी चीजें उसमें लॉन्ग टर्म डिमांड आएगी, लेकिन इमीडिएट डिमांड आए उसके लिए आपके हिसाब से कौन से प्रावधान किए गए?
नो दैट्स नॉट ट्रू. इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर प्रोजेक्ट में टेक लॉन्ग टाइम टू कंप्लीट, बट द डिमांड क्रिएशन विल हैपन इमीडिएटली बिकॉज एज द वर्क स्टार्ट्स गेट हैपनिंग इन द ग्राउंड पीपल आर गोइंग टू गेट वेजेस, ऑर्डर्स आर गोइंग टू बी बुक्ड फॉर कोर कमोडिटीज फॉर बिल्डिंग ऑफ दोज एसेट्स. So demand generation happens immediately. The project completion may happen later.
Number 10.
Ma'am, मैं मोनिका जी मीडिया से. मैम मेरा सवाल है कि कोविड और लॉकडाउन की वजह से बैंकों में काफ़ी एनपीए बढ़ा और आरबीआई की रिपोर्ट के हिसाब से भी कुछ 14% तक बढ़ सकता है इस साल सितंबर तक. तो ये जो 20,000 करोड़ रुपए की जो राशि जो बैंकों के लिए आपने जो अनाउंस की है, क्या ये पर्याप्त है उनको रिकैपिटलाइज करने के लिए? साथ ही ये जो 9.5% जो फिस्कल डेफिसिट है जीडीपी का, इसका इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ और इकोनॉमिक स्टेबिलिटी पर क्या असर रहेगा?
इसका असर अच्छा ही रहेगा, क्योंकि इसका मतलब है खर्च कर रहे हैं सरकार. इसके कारण एफडी फिस्कल डेफिसिट इतना तक पहुंचा है. जब खर्च कर रहे हैं और क्वालिटेटिवली अच्छा खर्च कर रहे हैं, उससे एम्प्लॉयमेंट बढ़ेगा. असर यही है. एम्प्लॉयमेंट बढ़ने में हर एक आदमी का हाथ में और पैसा होगा, जिससे डिमांड बढ़ेगी. सो द वर्चुअस साइकिल गेट्स बिल्ट.
और मैम ये जो
मैम, मैं शैलेश यादव हूँ ANI न्यूज एजेंसी से. मैम कस्टम ड्यूटी जो है गोल्ड पे एक तरफ तो आपने जो है कम करी है, 7.5% कर दिया उसको, और लेकिन सेस उस पर बढ़ा दिया है, तो इसका कितना इम्पैक्ट जो है गोल्ड और सिल्वर पर पड़ेगा? दूसरा मैम एक अल्कोहल पे है कि वो एक्साइज ड्यूटी जो है सेस जो है 100% बढ़ा दिया गया है, तो उसका कितना इम्पैक्ट पड़ेगा अल्कोहल पे?
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल मैंने जैसे शुरुआत में कही, कस्टम ड्यूटी का रिडक्शन करने के बाद सेस को उसके ऊपर लगाने में पूरे कस्टम ड्यूटी के गिरावट जो हुआ वो भरपाई करने के लिए सेस नहीं किया, उसको कम किया, मगर सेस जो ऐड किया वो कम ही स्तर पर ऐड किया है, जिससे एंड कंस्यूमर के ऊपर ज़्यादा और एडिशनल बोझ ना पड़े. Meaning, we reduced the customs duty and we levied a disproportionate amount of cess. So it was not the exact amount of reduction of customs duty that we levied in the form of a cess. So if, for example, 10% was brought down of customs, we have only added 5-6% of cess. So baki, if anything, has reduced the price to the end consumer, or else in some cases it retained the price. Kisi ka price uske karan zyada nahi hui. Ye readjustment hai jo excise duty ke naam par hame aata tha ya custom duty ke upar se hamare kamai thi, usko restructure karke usse ek carve out nikal karke agricultural infrastructure ke liye usko नाम देकर अलग तलग कर दिया, उससे एडिशनल कंस्यूमर के ऊपर बर्डन नहीं है.
15.
मैम दिस इज रुचि भाटिया फ्रॉम ईटी नाउ. आई वांट टू अंडरस्टैंड फ्रॉम यू द इकोनॉमिक सर्वे प्रोजेक्टेड अ नॉमिनल जीडीपी ऑफ 15.4%, द हाईएस्ट सिंस इंडिपेंडेंस, बट द बजट हैज पेग्ड जस्ट अबाउट 14.4%. व्हाई द डिफरेंस एंड व्हाई डज द बजट नॉट शेयर द सेम ऑप्टिमिज्म दैट द इकोनॉमिक सर्वे डिड ऑन द नॉमिनल जीडीपी?
If I can give a light-hearted reply, they are two different institutions preparing it. They are not opposite to each other. One may be conservative because it's finance ministry. The other is flamboyant because it's economic advisor.
56.
नमस्ते मैम, मैं आलोक प्रियदर्शी हूँ सीएनबीसी आवाज से। मेरा सवाल यह है कि जो आम आदमी कोविड के बाद एक्सपेक्ट कर रहा था कि उसकी जेब में पैसे पहुँचेंगे थ्रू टैक्स में डिडक्शन एग्जम्पशंस के जरिए, सरकार ने वो रास्ता नहीं चुना है, लेकिन फिर भी इस बजट से आम आदमी समझने की कोशिश कर रहा है कि आखिर किस तरह से उसे राहत मिली है, अगर दो तीन पॉइंट्स अगर बता सके तो।
एम्प्लॉयमेंट क्रिएशन के लिए बहुत सारे खर्च हैं, पैसा पब्लिक इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर बिल्ड करने के लिए बहुत बड़ा पैमाने पर दिया गया है, जिससे आम आदमी को तुरंत जॉब्स का अपॉर्चुनिटी मिलेगा। छोटे मोटे कारोबार बना करने वाले का एक्सपोर्ट के लिए इंसेंटिव स्कीम्स भी लाए हैं और डेफिनेशन एमएसएमई का बदल दिया, उनमें टैक्स सर्टिफिकेशन और ऑडिटर सर्टिफिकेशन ना लेने का वो सुविधा भी हम दिए। सो छोटे मोटे कारोबार करने वाले को उनके ऊपर कंप्लायंस का बर्डन कम कर दिया, डिमांड बढ़ाने के लिए एक्सपेंडिचर कर रहे हैं इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर में। सो जब इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के खर्च हो रही है, उनके वॉट एवर प्रोड्यूस दे प्रोड्यूस, वो सब मांगने के लिए, डिमांड बढ़ाने के लिए हम कदम उठाए हैं। सो छोटे लघु उद्यमी को, मिडिल क्लास को इससे ज़रूर राहत मिलेगा।
156 वित्त मंत्री जी, यहाँ पीछे प्रणय उपाध्याय हूँ एबीपी न्यूज़ से। मेरा सवाल ये है कि बजट के अंदर एक प्रस्ताव रखा गया है कि जो भी हाई इनकम एम्प्लॉयज़ हैं उनके प्रोविडेंट फंड से जो इनको टैक्स में इनकम, जो इंटरेस्ट में इनकम होती है, उसका कैप 2.5 लाख के करीब रखा गया है। क्या आप इसे थोड़ा सा समझा पाएंगे कि क्या एग्जैक्टली ये प्रोविजन है?
मैं ब्रॉडली बोलती हूँ एंड ऑल्सो एक्सपेंडिचर सेक्रेटरी इज हियर, ही कैन ऑल्सो एक्सप्लेन इट टू इट। अप टू 2.5 लाख we have kept as a ceiling that you can annually give it for this purpose, for which you get tax exemption, for which you get at 8% guaranteed interest return on that money, even that is tax exempt. What we have done now is, this fund is actually for the welfare of the workers, no doubt, and workers are not going to be affected by it, because anyone who earns less than 2 lakhs per month will still be paying his 12% without a hitch. It is only for big ticket money which comes into it, because it has tax benefit and also assured about 8% return. You find huge amounts, some to the extent of 1 crore also being put into this each month. For somebody who puts 1 crore into this fund each month, what should be his salary? So for him to give both tax concession and also an assured 8% return, we thought is probably not comparable with an employee with about 2 lakhs who puts that money, gets tax concession and also gets 8% return. That person who will still be allowed to put money, but of course with a ceiling of 2.5 lakhs, will get for that amount tax concession. And for that amount, 8% interest. So we are not reducing any worker's right, but at the same time, getting tax exemption and also getting 8% rate of interest for somebody who puts 1 crore per month into the account, we thought maybe is not right. And therefore, we have put that ceiling. 1 minute. Somnathan, would you want to explain something more to it?
No, I'll just add 2 statistics. The number of people who will who actually contribute more than the sum that we have indicated is less than 1% of the total number of contributors in the EPFO. So the people it affects is actually those who are not workers by any stretch of imagination, but are using the EPFO, which they were entitled to do, but they are a very, very small fraction of the total number of contributors.
264.
Ma'am, this side. This is Abhishek from Republic TV. Ma'am, you made a very interesting mention of a portal for gig economy. I think this is the first time this was found mentioned. Like, what kind of social security measures are we expecting for gig economy, contractual workers, laborers? Because post-COVID, I think the numbers must have swelled.
So a portal is going to be created where the gig workers, the construction workers, the migrant workers, their data would be picked up and kept there. And all the schemes relating to health, education, even the ones that we were trying to do during the COVID times would actually flow from there. So basically this is an attempt we have a lot of data available with us for various segments of the society. This is one data we thought we should have because people come and go, and we saw during the COVID times that we actually needed that, so it is for that reason. And the codes that have come up actually will provide benefits to these gig workers. The contributions will come from their employers, and they would also be entitled to the benefits of Social Security as much as is available to the labor today.
22.
Hi, ma'am. Sumesh Jha from Bloomberg Quint. I would like to read out an extract from the Finance Commission report to seek a clarity. It says that keeping in view the strategic requirement for national defense, we have recalibrated the relative share of union and states in gross revenue received by reducing our grants component by 1%. So does it mean that the devolution to states is actually 41% and not 42%? And second, you've said that in the Finance Commission, you have accepted the glide path in terms of fiscal deficit. They have said that the fiscal deficit target they have recommended to be at 4% for FY26, and I think we have targeted it at 4.5%. So, so it's different from the one which is.
I have Somanathan answer some of the questions as much as DEA, but then the coming down to 41% has nothing to do with defense. It came down to 41% even last time when JNK was formed. And when a state became a union territory, the funding of that state or that union territory will be with the center and not with the state itself, which is a union territory now. So the 42 was brought down to 41. And to that extent, because it was recognized as a union territory, the center has been given the responsibility to fund it. So 41 has nothing to do with defense funding.
The Commission has recommended a deficit of 4% and a conditional extra deficit of 0.5% dependent on power reforms. So that is exactly what has been accepted. There's no deviation between what has been accepted for the states and what has been recommended for the Commission by the Commission for 21-22.
80.
Ma'am, this is Mukesh Kaushik from Dainik Bhaskar. Ma'am, at a time when country is facing huge military challenge at eastern border, armed forces were expecting a substantial hike in their budget, which is not reflected in this budget. How can we counter a country like China, whose defense budget is close to $200 billion, five times higher than us?
I will give you the exact figures as to what has been given for defense. Defense expenditure, in the sense, in the last 3 years, has been accommodated. A lot of powers have been delegated to the vice chiefs, who can take instant call on revenue, and some capital expenditure accounts were also, the power were also given to them to expend as is required by the situation. So for defense, we have not really undermined any of that. And one other thing was accepting in principle the suggestion that non-lapsable fund should be provided for defense, which was one of the recommendations given by the Finance Commission. In principle, we've accepted that. But what formulation that will take will be different. That is something which the ministries will have to work out as and when they will want to work out. But specifics, Tarun, would you want to give? And Somnathan wants to.
So the I would point your attention to the fact that defense consists of three components. There is a revenue component, which is predominantly salaries, fuel, etc. Then there is a pension component, and then there is a capital component. The most significant component to your question is the capital component. The budget allocation in 2020-21 was 1,13,734. It has gone up to 1,35,060, which is an increase of close to 20%, which is a substantial increase.
116.
मैडम नमस्ते मेरा नाम अतुल अग्रवाल है मैं हिंदी खबर न्यूज़ चैनल का संपादक हूं हम लगातार बात करते हैं किसान की हम बात करते हैं जवान की हम जय जवान जय किसान कहते हैं आपने कहा सरकार खर्च कर रही है सरकार इसलिए खर्च कर रही है कि सरकार को टैक्स के तौर पे एक रकम मिलती है जिसको सरकार जनहित में खर्च करती है हम अन्नदाता की बात करते हैं हम करदाताओं के मोटिवेशन के लिए हमारे बजट में क्या है करदाताओं के मोटिवेशन के लिए इस बजट में क्या है वो हम जानना चाहते हैं
करदाता के ऊपर जो प्रेशर था कि क्या डिस्क्रिशन के वजह से उनके ऊपर दबाव आएगा, क्या टैक्स टेररिज्म की बात करते थे 2 साल पहले तक, उन सभी विषयों में बाय ब्रिंगिंग इन फेसलेस असेसमेंट, फेसलेस अपील्स, डायरेक्ट टैक्सेशन में भी, इनडायरेक्ट में भी धीरे धीरे से ले आ रहे हैं, करदाता के ऊपर रॉन्ग डिस्क्रिशन बेस्ड प्रेशर नहीं होना चाहिए, वो एक विषय है। दूसरा, 6 साल तक आपके अकाउंट ओपन करेंगे, ऐसे एक सुविधा टैक्स अथॉरिटीज को था, उसको हम कम करते हुए वी सेड विद इन 3 ईयर्स यू ओपन और डू वॉट एवर बट क्लोज द होल थिंग, जिससे करदाता के ऊपर जो अनसर्टनिटी था, पता नहीं कब खुलेगा मेरा अकाउंट, उसके पीछे क्या इंटेंशन होगा, दैट अनसर्टनिटी हैज बीन रिमूव्ड। सो नोबडीज अकाउंट विल बी ओपन्ड आफ्टर 3 ईयर्स। हाउएवर 10 साल तक ओपन कर सकते थे अगर आपके ऊपर सर्च हुआ या कुछ हुआ, उसको भी हम बोल रहे हैं कि ओनली इन केसेस वेयर 50 लाख से ज़्यादा आपका अनडिस्क्लोज्ड इनकम था, फिर 10 साल तक ओपन करने का पॉसिबिलिटी है, एंड दैट टू व्हेन इट इज ओपन्ड विद द परमिशन ऑफ द प्रिंसिपल कमिश्नर ऑफ टैक्स। ये सब नहीं, 1 मिनट, यू हैव नॉट इवन हर्ड हाउ इट्स गोइंग टू बी इंप्लीमेंटेड। मोटिवेशन के बारे में आप जजमेंट कर दीजिए, आप प्लीज एक्सप्लेन करिए हाउ मोटिवेशन कहाँ मिसिंग है जी, अभी घोषणा हुआ पॉलिसी।
वी गो टू द नेक्स्ट 14।
मैम वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून, सपना दास हियर फ्रॉम सीएनबीसी टीवी 18। मैम क्विक वन ऑन दिस इन्वेस्टमेंट, मैम यू हैव सेड इन योर बजट स्पीच समवेयर दैट बेसिकली बेयर मिनिमम प्रेजेंस विल बी रिक्वायर्ड एज फार एज द स्ट्रेटेजिक सेक्टर्स आर कंसर्न, यू ऑलरेडी लिस्टेड दोज, व्हाट डज इट इंडिकेट, एंड ऑल्सो मैम दिस 1.75 लाख करोड़ नंबर दैट यू हैव सेट आउट फॉर FY22, इट्स लोअर देन 210 ऑफ लास्ट ईयर, डज इट इंक्लूड योर द न्यू अनाउंसमेंट दैट यू मेड फॉर द बैंक्स एंड द इंश्योरेंस कंपनी, एंड वन क्विक वन मैम ऑल्सो ऑन दिस बैड बैंक, नॉट यू आर नॉट कॉलिंग इट बैड बैंक बट यू आर सेइंग लाइक यू नो अ न्यू ARC, we should pick up the bad loans and dispose it off to AIF. So what is that that you have envisaged there? Any amendments that may be required down the line, ma'am? Thank you very much.
Actually, the policy has been announced that there'll be 4 sectors, broad sectors, and there'll be a bare minimum presence of these sectors, and there is a mechanism which has been created through an alternate mechanism where Niti Aayog will put up, and then bare minimum will be, find out. That's the question number one. The other one was the target. I think 1,75,000 is an achievable target. The pipeline has been created, and that pipeline will keep on being created. And new policy will also create new pipeline, and that will carry on, because this program, which is there for 3 to 4 years of this, there are several companies which will actually be disinvested, and it will be a rolling program. So therefore, 1,75,000 we are hopeful of achieving this year.
I think we move to the next question. 50.
Hello. आवाज आ रही है मेरी? मैं आमिर हूँ न्यूज़ नेशन से। इस समय आप देख रही होंगी कि कई बॉर्डर्स पे किसान बैठे हुए हैं, और एग्री इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर जो है लगाया गया, इसका इस्तेमाल आप कैसे करेंगी, और क्या ये किसानों के लिए फायदेमंद होगा, आगे इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर में आप इसको लगाएंगी, कैसे इसका इस्तेमाल होगा, कितना कलेक्शन हो पाएगा, और किस तरह से? और दूसरा मेरा छोटा सवाल ये है कि जब घर से लोग निकलते हैं तो सर एक छोटा सा सवाल है, पेट्रोल डीजल को लेकर के बहुत ज्यादा सवाल हैं लोगों के, क्योंकि उस पर लगातार सवाल पूछे जा रहे हैं कि कब तक कुछ एक्साइज ड्यूटी में राहत मिलेगी या नहीं, जो आपने अभी उस पर अलग से सेस लगाया।
बॉर्डर पे किसान बैठे हुए हैं, हम सब समझ रहे हैं, अगर किसी किसान के मन में प्रश्न है तो एग्रीकल्चर मिनिस्टर उनके साथ बैठ करके बात करने में कभी भी संकोच नहीं किया, कितने भी राउंड क्यों ना हो बैठते हैं, और बार बार ये भी बोलते हैं कि ये तीनों कानून से आप क्लॉस बाय क्लॉस कंडवार चर्चा करिए, हम करने के लिए तैयार हैं। इसीलिए मैं मानती हूँ अभी भी कि चर्चा ही रास्ता है. चर्चा करने के लिए सरकार ओपन है. और कल परसों पार्लियामेंट के शुरुआत से पहले प्रधानमंत्री जी वो जो ऑफर है उसको टेबल पर अभी भी है करके माना. इसीलिए मैं मानती हूँ किसान जिनको भी मन में कुछ प्रश्न है, संकोच है और डाउट्स है, वो ज़रूर बात करने के लिए आगे आए, सरकार से बात करें. वो एक विषय है. दूसरा, ये एग्रीकल्चरल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर डेवलपमेंट सेस का मैटर है. ये मैंने मेरे एग्रीकल्चरल सेक्शन जब मैं पढ़ रही थी उसमें स्पष्ट बोले कि एग्रीकल्चरल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के लिए हम खर्च करेंगे और बहुत सारे इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के लिए वैरायटी हमने क्लॉज स्कीम्स बोले हैं. अब तक जो सिर्फ पोटैटो टोमेटो के लिए स्कीम है उसको अभी 23 पेरिशेबल क्रॉप्स के लिए ले आ रहे हैं. ऐसे ही नाबार्ड के द्वारा जहां ऑलरेडी 5,000 करोड़ का अमाउंट उनको दिया गया उसको डबल कर रहे हैं. एग्रीकल्चरल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर बहुत सारे आयाम मतलब फेसेस में करते हैं, बहुत सारे रूपरेखा में आता है. मैं ये भी बोली हूँ कि APMC का इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर का भी हम फंड करेंगे. सो एग्रीकल्चरल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर फंड का रास्ता बहुत सारे हैं, उन सब के लिए ही ये फंड है.
नंबर 9.
हाँ, इससे पहले आत्मनिर्भर भारत के समय भी 1,00,000 करोड़ का अनाउंसमेंट हुआ एग्रीकल्चरल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के लिए ही. उसके अलावा अभी भी बोल रहे हैं कि इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर इंप्रूव करने के लिए हम करेंगे. ई नैम भी एग्रीकल्चर के लिए ही है और उसमें अभी और 1,000 न्यू मार्केट्स को जोड़ा जाएगा. पेट्रोल डीजल इज नाउ इट्स ऑलरेडी ओपन टू द मार्केट और ऑयल मार्केटिंग कंपनीज उसमें उनके अपने स्तर पर निर्णय करते हैं. अंडर रिकवरी होता है तो उनको वो भरपाई करते हैं. उसमें सरकार के रोल, पर्टिकुलरली केंद्र सरकार के रोल में ये बोलना चाहती हूँ क्योंकि हमारा पेट्रोल एक्साइज के ऊपर जो हम अमाउंट हम लेते हैं वो फिक्स्ड अमाउंट है, वैल्यू बेस्ड नहीं, एडवलोरम नहीं है. हर एक रुपया के लिए इतना आना है बस. इसमें अंदाजन वर्कआउट करने में मैं प्लीज समबडी करेक्ट मी, इफ वी गेट 13 to 14 rupees, स्टेट्स बिकॉज दे गेट इट थ्रू एडवलोरम गेट नियरली 30 rupees. इसीलिए केंद्र सरकार के ऊपर ये उनके निर्णय नहीं होता. ऑयल मार्केटिंग कंपनीज जो खरीदते हैं, रिफाइन करते हैं, फिर डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करते हैं, उनके ऊपर डिसीशन है, वो डिसीशन लेते हैं. फिर भी सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट को उससे आने वाले अमाउंट इतना ही है. ये इस प्रोपोर्शन में एग्जैक्ट अमाउंट नहीं बोली, 13-14 rupees अगर हम कमाते हैं, 30-35 rupees तक स्टेट्स कमाते हैं. सो ये भी हम ध्यान में रखना जरूरी है.
मैम मेघना मित्तल फ्रॉम न्यूज राइज, आई वॉन्टेड टू आस्क यू Ma'am, I wanted to ask you that will there be a concerted effort from the government in FY22 to improve the quality of fiscal consolidation and reduce the off-budget borrowing so that we can put all the expenses on the balance sheet?
You're asking a government which has set a record in it. If only I allow Somanathan to speak about it, if I allow the CEA to speak about it, he can speak for hours. It will be a matter of or subject of study in universities as to how public finance has to be cleaned up, has to be transparent. I think, and I am not boasting here, we've made brave decisions to keep it all open and transparent and clean it up. I would like each of them to say a few things so that it will benefit you.
In fact, there is a statement here. There was a statement last year too. This time it is Annexure 6. So if you look at that statement, we have detailed all the extra budgetary resources that have been borrowed from 2017-18 onwards. And you will see that the provision for this year is, for specific purposes, is zero. For an unidentified contingency, we have 30,000 crores. The entire food subsidy is now on the budget. The entire food subsidy for the revised estimates this year is on the budget. Arrears of food subsidy, which were earlier given from the National Small Savings Funds for 2016-17, 2017-18, have been paid from the budget in the revised estimates 2020-21. So there are, basically the story is, there is no extra budgetary resource for 2021-22, barring a contingency of 30,000, which we have kept for a rainy day. But other than that, there is actually nothing more. I would challenge you to please look in and find any extra budgetary resource that you can find here.
262.
No, I just wanted to add actually that last time the first step was taken to actually put it out transparently in the budget speech. This time, as Dr. Somanathan has said, actually it's completely transparent. So, you know, I must say that I'm surprised by the question.
Ma'am, this
I'd just like to emphasize, I think if it has not been caught up, normally the NSSF was used to fund the subsidy given to the FCI. This time that has also been onboarded in the budget. In the RE also, we have brought a major portion of that into the budget. And also for the next year, we have got the whole amount into the budget. So that's a big transparent thing. That is what everybody's been asking for, and it's been delivered.
Ma'am, this is Krishnanand Tripathi. This side, ma'am. This side. Last year when you presented budget for this year, you estimated as per revised estimate that your fiscal deficit will be 3.8%, some 7.66 lakh crore rupees. And you invoked encasing committee's escape clause. But when we see the actual provisional number, it is 9.34 lakh crore rupees, a jump of 1.68 lakh crore rupees, or some 21%. There is an impression that this 9.5% fiscal deficit number has been artificially kept below 10%. When the finance bill will be passed after a few months, this number of 9.5% will be crossed like 10% as happened last year. How do you respond to this thing, ma'am?
Wait a minute, how do you solve is what? You've created a problem, I'm here to solve it. None of that is right, but you'll hear the story, don't worry.
I'm quite amazed at your question. That you are imputing motives to our numbers here. The numbers have never been, they have been very transparent this time, and let me assure you that they will be 9.5. It could go to 9.45, it will not go beyond that.
I think it's enough. I think it has been answered now. Yeah.
No, last year's number, let me.
Wait a minute. You'll hear more of us speaking on it. Don't worry. You will have complete clarity before you leave.
Last year's number went up for two reasons. One, the month of March was fully affected by COVID. That was the peak month of tax collection. And before the end of March, before taxes became due, the Government of India extended the dates for payment of both direct and indirect taxes. So a considerable amount of revenue, which was expected to come in the previous fiscal year, did not come by design. Because it was extended, because it was COVID, in the Garib Kalyan package, dates were extended, number one. Number two, the finance minister had announced in her budget speech that we would make the corrections necessary to pay the amounts that were said to be due to the states under the GST compensation. These are the two reasons why the number went up in 2021, to make up for the compensation to the states, which was paid from the amounts of 2019-20. And secondly, because of the unexpected revenue shortfall in the month of March. There was no intentional under-projection of the deficit. Both were events which happened.
Ma'am, I would also want to add, just on the projections itself.
Itne sare log ek hi mat se baat kar rahe hain. Aap usko bhi notice kariye.
Secretary Economic Affairs had mentioned about the fact, and ma'am also mentioned that the economic survey's projection for GDP growth was actually a little higher than that of the budget. Also, one critical point to note here is 2.5% of GDP, madam, has allocated for infrastructure spending. the fiscal multipliers on infrastructure in the year in which it happens is 2.5 times. If the government spends 1 rupee, 2.5 rupee comes in that year. So just multiply 2.5 by 2.5%. Of the 11%, about 6.25% can come just from infrastructure. I think you can actually from there project actually how conservative the estimation is, not just for this year and for next year as well. I think there's been complete transparency in the way actually the projections have been made, and something that I actually as an independent economist, I'm really happy about.
20.
Ma'am, this is Aishwarya Paliwal from India Today. Ma'am, Rahul Gandhi tweeted some time back. He said, forget putting cash in the hands of people. Modi government plans to hand over India's asset to his crony capitalist friends. Ma'am, how would you respond to this?
I think we've responded on this particular question, which he repeats once in 15 days.
Yeah.
And I don't think you need a response on it. My budget speaks for itself. And a party which even today doesn't know how to explain, if I take one example of Kerala under Congress, giving away one of the seaport development on invitation to one of the crony capitalists that he's talking about. Can he explain as to how, for developing Virinjam port, a crony capitalist, I wouldn't call him that, but he uses that word, a crony capitalist was invited by the Congress party, the government then there in Kerala. If that one thing can be explained by the Congress party, I would agree he can go on doing his pet project of repeating this kind of a tweet every 15 days. But if he can't answer that, I think Rahul Gandhi should understand that either he understands nothing of what he's speaking about or he's being ill-advised.
53. Please just... I think you must honor this one. Yeah, please just all these questions later on. Yeah. Yes, 53. Yeah.
I'm Shubham Batra from Infamous Media. Ma'am, congratulations on the budget. It's fairly clean and transparent.
1 minute. Are you speaking for all your colleagues?
I think this year I am, slightly. Okay. Ma'am, my question's on the borrowing program for FY22. In FY21, the borrowing program was largely aided by the emergency steps that RBI had taken on liquidity, maintaining it in surplus, and the open market operation purchases. Ma'am, how will you manage this large borrowing program this year, given that those steps may be wounded this year?
The borrowing in quantum terms would be lower than last year, and we have actually come out openly and said that we would be looking for a gross borrowing of about 12 lakh crores, and the net borrowing would be close to about 9 point some lakh crores. So what are the options? We've got the options of GSEC, we've got the options of short term, and we are also hoping that we'll also enter the global indices in the coming year, and that would assist us in picking up this money. I may also add here that when we do this, when we announce this, we are always in touch with the central bank, and I have a complete assurance that we would be able to raise this money and raise this money at a reasonable rate.
19.
Ma'am, I just want to know from you about the GDP projection for this coming next year. Where do you see, we've heard the economic survey, where do you realistically see it going? And last year, I asked you this question about long-term capital gains, and you said, you know, let it have one full year, financial year to look at it. You haven't touched it this year. So is it that it's going to, it's there to permanently to stay?
I said, yes, let it have a full cycle of the number of years required. But 2020 is not a regular year. So I need to have that taken off in the calculation, and we need to give that much time. What was your first one?
In terms of GDP growth,
do you want one of you all to answer? Yeah. Any one of you all to answer?
I think I already answered then.
She's also given it. Her budget statement says that. So why do you say that she's not said that?
38?
14.4% nominal.
I think just we move ahead.
Real will be 10.5. 4 is the deflator.
Ma'am, Gulveen Desai from Economic Times. Here, on your left. Ma'am, two questions. One.
No, only one. Others are there. Yeah, please.
Sir, I've got a chance after
no,
a long time.
No, wait a minute. Why do you say that only to her? You didn't stop the guys.
No.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
Ma'am, two questions. One is that the increased revenue that you're expected to get from the cess that you'll be levying, if you could quantify that. And two, a timeline on the PSB divestment, please.
We have proposed this agriculture and development cess only on about 14 to 15 items. And as has been explained by the finance minister, that it has been done in such a manner that it does not impose any extra burden on the taxpayer. The total amount that we estimate is about 30,000 crores.
Number 11.
I think from today onwards, we have started work on that. So we'll come to you the moment we are ready. We have to make certain legislative amendments also. So work is already on.
Ujjwal Narayan from NewsRise, ma'am. This side. Ma'am, you have announced ARC during your speech in the budget speech. So I want everyone want to know what will be the structure of this ARC and how it will be different from the ARCs which are still working, which can solve the problem of banking sectors, which is in future there is suspicion that they have a huge NPA.
So with the permission of ma'am, let me first of all tell you that since 2015, you are aware that the asset quality review was undertaken. Banks, they're all cleaned up as far as the balance sheet are concerned. Issue is that a lot of assets, these bad assets, are locked up and they are not able to realize the value. Now, how does this work, this new model which ma'am today announced, is that ARC AMC, an entity, will be put in place by the public sector banks and also the other lenders in the private space as well. And the first and foremost, the important thing which will happen is the aggregation of assets, which doesn't happen otherwise. Why not the existing ARCs? The existing ARCs, barring four or five of them, the others are very thinly capitalized, and they are unable to deal with assets which are of the size of more than 500 crores, which are complex to be resolved, and need a professional setup to go ahead with the resolution. So this model, which ma'am announced this morning in the budget, will be taken forward. We will need certain dispensation from the regulator. So work is on, and you'll quickly see that on the ground. Thank you.
39.
There may be some government support if required. Otherwise, what ma'am says, the banks will put together the initial capital that is required for setting up the ARC. It will be, in a way, cash neutral. We'll explain the details as we go along.
Yeah. Good evening, ma'am. Shishir here. Ma'am, can you tell me the name of the two banks and one general insurance company which are going to be divested? And the second thing is, what will be the share of asset monetization? What will be the sale proceed from the asset monetization in total disinvestment proceed? Thank you, ma'am.
If I can tell you now, I would have said it in my speech.
Number six. Yeah. It's there.
Ma'am, I'm Nikunj from Business Standard. Going back to the question on PSBs, will ownership norms for holding these banks also be relaxed in consultation with RBI so that this exercise itself of privatizing banks picks up? And secondly, ma'am, in your Atmanirbhar Bharat package, you had announced this privatization policy and it spoke about having at least four PSUs in strategic sectors. So maximum number of PSUs was supposed to be four in strategic sectors. And now the speech says that there will be a bare minimum. So is that ceiling of four PSUs being removed? What would now be the new ceiling? Your clarification.
The cabinet has given approval for is the policy. Yeah, I announced, and after that, it is sharp focused when it went to the cabinet for approval. So what has been announced today in the budget speech will be the policy approved by the cabinet. Yeah, but
it is part of the annexure, so that basically is giving you the sectors that are strategic, and it basically says that bare minimum companies will remain in the public sector and the remaining will be privatized in the strategic sector, and in the non-strategic sector eventually all the companies would be privatized. So it is basically a very focused and a forward-looking policy that has come out.
18.
No. So there are various options. Therefore, we are not going to, you know, we have not yet decided what is the options available. One is to amend that, or we can sort of the two banks that ma'am has announced. That can also we look at another formulation where we need not tinker with those things. So we'll examine that. So it is under examination. It's already, you know, being looked into. So we'll take this forward.
मंत्री जी मेरा सवाल आपसे है कि आत्मनिर्भर भारत के लिए जो आपने बजट पेश किया उसमें ये बताएं कि जो अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट हुआ है कोरोना को लेके लाखों नौकरी जो गई है उसका दोबारा से नौकरी आने में कितना पॉसिबिलिटी है और दूसरा है कि जो 75 साल से ऊपर के सीनियर सिटीजन हैं उनको क्या सबको इनकम टैक्स रिटर्न नहीं भरना पड़ेगा
इनकम टैक्स रिटर्न की जो बात आपने पूछी जिनका उम्र 75 साल से ज़्यादा है और जिनको सिर्फ पेंशन मिलता है और उनका यदि फिक्स डिपॉजिट उसी बैंक में है और सिर्फ उनको इंटरेस्ट का अगर इनकम होता है तो उनको इनकम टैक्स रिटर्न भरने की ज़रूरत नहीं है जितना इनकम टैक्स उनको देना है वो बैंक ही उतना काट करके सरकार को जमा कर देगा तो इसमें शर्त यही है कि उनको सिर्फ पेंशन मिलना चाहिए और उनका फिक्स डिपॉजिट उसी बैंक में होना चाहिए अगर उनका कुछ और इनकम है तो फिर अपना वो रिटर्न भरेंगे क्योंकि उनके लिए वही ज़्यादा ये सहूलियत का होगा लेकिन कई जो 75 साल से ज़्यादा के उम्र के जो वृद्ध हैं ज़्यादातर लोगों का सिर्फ पेंशन इनकम होता है या उसी पेंशन से कुछ पैसा बचता है तो वो फिर वो फिक्स डिपॉजिट में उनका रहता है उससे उनको इंटरेस्ट मिलता है उनके लिए हर साल रिटर्न भरना काफ़ी एक जटिल काम होता था तो उसी को सुविधाजनक बनाने के लिए ये व्यवस्था की गई है कि बैंक उनका इनकम टैक्स काट लेगा और उनको इनकम टैक्स भरने की ज़रूरत नहीं पड़ेगी
38
Vrishti from Bloomberg News. You mentioned that we have seen few mini budgets last year and now we have a full budget. So do you think all these measures would be enough to bring back the economy on growth path or more measures might be needed and you would be open to taking those? Because economic survey last week mentioned that, you know, sustained and calibrated measures would be needed to go back on the path of high growth trajectory.
I think you go by the policy of Dil Mange More. So we had already, as Madam had mentioned in our budget speech also, we came up with 5 kind of mini budgets, and there are huge announcements. For example, Agriculture Infrastructure Fund, the ECLGS, which is supporting the MSME sector. And this has been followed with a very visionary, I would say, a budget given by the Honorable Finance Minister. So I think this itself will bring us a path, and we have also given you a path that we are going to follow in the next 3 or 4 years, and these policies would actually keep rolling out, and I'm sure we'll be back to our growth days very soon.
Last question, 42.
Manoj Kumar from Reuters News Agency. Hello. So just we want to know, like, so in your
please
view,
please put on this mic.
Hello. Sorry. So what will be the impact of the overall budget on the inflation, and how much support we are expecting from the RBI in dividend for the next year? Thank you.
Please just this is not the way. Just wait. This photographers are also asking the question. Just please wait. This question has been asked. We will give you the opportunity next one. Yeah.
As has been explained in the budget, very well that we are actually borrowing this money not to spend on items which are not going to have a multiplier effect, but we are going to invest and hugely invest into infrastructure. So I presume that it will not have that inflationary impact that you are mentioning. So we have taken that into account. And what was the second question? So RBI dividend would come, and we have actually said that our non-tax revenue would be 2,43,000 crores. It was last time 2,10,000 crores. So you can also presume that it is not something that we have actually inflated the number that we are going to get from them. We will definitely achieve this 2.43 lakh crores of non-tax revenue. So I think, and we are in touch with RBI. We know how much is it they are going to give us, hopefully at the end of March when their year ends. But it's not something to be disclosed to the people at the moment.
Yes, madam, now you can ask your question. Please use the mic here.
Madam, we are a photographer. In corona lockdown time, so many photographers, not only other sector also, lost the job. And they are all on the road. And it is more than 40 to 40, 55 years old these days. And how you can help them, how your budget can help for them?
I think this is being addressed in the Ministry of INB. Actually, INB Ministry is taking care, but still the Ministry of Finance officers. Yeah.
I think what Madam has said in terms of creation of jobs, the fact that we are going back to a growing economy, that we are going to spend in infrastructure, and the COVID vaccines have come. So once the COVID vaccines have come, the people are going to actually go for tourism with a vengeance. And I think the photographers, not the photographers, so they will get all the jobs back.
No. Even otherwise, I think that scheme about which I spoke, if your employers want to take you back, the government is coming up with paying your PF for next 2 years, your monthly installments which you have to pay. The employer doesn't have to pay. So it is your employer who should benefit and utilize the scheme which has been put up by the government to take you back onto the jobs. The government has extended itself. Yeah?
I would like to thank the Finance Minister, MOS Finance, and the senior officers from the Ministry of Finance. Thank you very much, friends. Thank you.